What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. One number that's often measured while unit testing is code coverage. Simply put, this is a percentage measurement of exactly how much of your application code is being successfully hit by your unit tests. It's certainly not a guarantee of perfection. Just because you have exhausted a line doesn't mean you have tested every possible combination of data and options that could have gone into that line. But code coverage will certainly let you know what you're missing. Even the most basic code coverage reports will typically tell you different numbers for how many of your classes are being tested, and within those, how much of your methods are being tested. It will even tell you if the individual lines of code inside those methods are being hit by a test. Now, as you might expect, this is something that is done with a tool that can perform this analysis. And there are a lot of code coverage tools. Some are free, quite a lot are commercial. What I'll be using throughout this video is a built-in coverage plugin in IntelliJ, as you can see in front of you. Now, to see what a coverage report looks like, let's take the previous example we used throughout this unit testing / GDD series and try to run these tests with coverage with the help of our IDE. The result is something like that. Making use of TDD helps you actually have a very high coverage, as we did here. And in front of you now is a typical coverage report. It tells you which classes are being covered by your tests, which methods, and even which lines inside these classes and methods. When you open this class in IntelliJ, you will see that even outside of the report, next to the line numbers on the left, the lines covered are marked in green, and the non-covered lines in red. Okay, before diving any further into the technicalities of code coverage and its practices, let's answer why should we even attempt to measure code coverage? What is the added value behind this measurement? Well, by now we know that unit testing improves the quality of our software and the predictability of its releases. However, how do we know if the unit tests we wrote actually test the code they are meant to? How do we make sure that these tests are enough? Do we need to write more of them? These are some of the questions that code coverage measurements seek to answer. Code coverage helps us know how well our tests actually test the code, and whether we have enough testing in place to maintain the test quality over the lifecycle of a project. Now, while everything we said is important, you should remember that code coverage should not be overvalued. It is not a remedy for all our testing problems. Coverage generally follows an 80-20 rule. If you manage to reach 100%, well, good for you. But as you add more code, increasing coverage percentages will become very difficult, as some code may be very difficult to reach with practical levels of testing. So keep in mind that coverage measurement is not a replacement for good code review and good programming practices. And in general, you should adopt a reasonable coverage target and aim for even coverage across all of the modules that make up your code, as relying on a single overall coverage figure can hide large gaps in coverage. With that said, the next thing we're going to tackle is the types of coverage, and in this video we'll take a look at the most important four of them: function, statement, branch, and condition coverage. First, function coverage. It tells you how many of the functions or methods defined in your application have been called. So in this example, to reach 100% function coverage, our method has to be called at least once by our tests, no matter what arguments we pass to it. Now, statement coverage is very similar to line coverage. Its main purpose is to cover all the possible paths, lines, and statements in the source code. In the same example we had, we will reach 100% coverage if this method is called by our tests with two negative parameters, because in this case, every line in the function would be executed, including both system outputs. Now, branch coverage, on the other hand, ensures that each decision from every branch is executed at least once. It helps measure fractions of independent code segments and finds out sections having no branches. The method we have can be represented using the following diagram, and calling all of the branches will be satisfied if we invoke this method with the parameters you see in front of you. In the first case, both if conditions are met and both system.outs are executed, while in the second case, the first condition is not satisfied, which prevents the execution of the first printout. Finally, condition coverage makes sure that each Boolean sub-expression was evaluated to both true and false. In our same example, we will have to call this method with the following parameters, let's say, to satisfy 100% condition coverage. In the first example, the first condition is evaluated to true, and the second to false. And in the second example, the first example is evaluated to false and the second to true. Okay, I am going to end this video with a couple common policies related to code coverage. The first and most important one is that code coverage must not decrease throughout the lifecycle of your project. On top of being important, this is one of the easiest policies to automate. The idea here is that the code coverage ratio must never decrease. So, if the current code has a 75% code coverage, and your new change introduces 80 lines of code, at least 60 of those must be tested. The second policy is that test files should have owners. You see, it is often beneficial to define code owners for the tests themselves. This means that any developer can change the implementation without formal reviewers, but logic changes should be approved by a senior developer or manager. Okay, my final words on the topic are that code coverage isn't a guarantee of perfection. As it tells you how much testing you are doing, it is not necessarily a good metric of how well you are testing your product. But if you manage to properly implement it and use it while developing your applications, especially if you're following a TDD approach, it will certainly help improve the quality of your software. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.